Mr. Channon, that wonderful Arrowhead presentation will raise your history grade to a D+.
All right, my top score!
As for you, Verne Brown, either you provide an item for tomorrow's show and tell, or you must play Prince Charming in the drama club's presentation of Sleeping Beauty.
That means I'd have to kiss Beatrice Spaulding. I'd rather be dead as a dinosaur than kiss Beatrice Spaulding. Hey! Instant brainstorm!
Thanks for loaning me the car, Doc. I'll be back in a flash.
Success!
Hey, Vernie, you sure this won't get you into trouble?
Pop said I can't take the car. He didn't say anything about you. Let's see. How many zeros in 1 zillion BC?
Back to the future is my favorite thing. Always talk about it and write songs to sing. Even though there was never a part four, Marty McFly is coming back for more. I don't make money, get no fame. Love for these characters is what I blame. Podcast about comics and cartoons and more, 'cause there's still things to explore in Marchy McFly 4. It's Marchy McFly 4. Can you feel it?
Happy Friday, everybody. It's March 29th.
Which means
it's the 29th day of the fourth year of Marchy McFly. Folks, we finally came to an ending. Not the ending of Marchy McFly, but the ending of the animated series. Today, we're talking about the season 2 finale and the series finale from Back to the Future, the animated series. But, folks, this isn't just your normal, everyday episode. There's someone else here. There's a very special guest here tonight in the Marchy McFly Studios. Returning to Geek Mentality for his 8th appearance. He's been in 3 previous Marchy McFlys. He was in Joggist. And he's been in 3 sitcom All Ye Faithfuls. My friend, he won't put his camera on because he doesn't want me to see me without his pants, him without his pants on. Eric, how are you doing this fine evening?
I should be a co-host by now. That's what I should be doing.
You really should be. You've been on the show more than anyone else.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. Yeah,
I think so. Yes, you are the...
Well, thank you for having me.
I'm grateful. I apologize for making you watch this episode. I apologize for finding out that you actually bought the DVD as well. But you did watch this episode.
But I also don't have a DVD player, which is even
so that even worked
better.
Out great. So
yeah,
you
I forgot about that.
You just love physical media. It's on your shelf. You were the guy with the laser disc. I've said it a million times. He's the only person I've ever met. I went to his house that actually had a laser disc. I thought it was the coolest thing. We watched a Guns N' Roses Metallica concert?
No, it's Guns N' Roses.
Guns N' Roses concert.
Tokyo.
Yes, it was like, wow. And then you just have to flip it over halfway through. This is amazing. And now he's do you still have any of those laser discs?
I still have the Guns N' Roses.
See, and it's just as useful as the Back to the Future DVDs. I actually had to get a DVD player for my computer just to watch these and to put them up on our Google Drive so that you could get a look at
Thank you.
Did you watch any other episodes besides this one?
Absolutely not.
That's good. So you don't have the rich knowledge that I have from having watched every single episode of this third-rate series.
I watched maybe the first episode for half of it, and then I just turned it off. It was that bad.
What's interesting is that the episode we're about to talk about, you've actually said you've seen it before, or you remember it.
I do, yes. So I'm not sure if it when it originally aired, but I do recall watching this episode at one time before, mostly because the dinosaur I thought was a ripoff of Mario Brothers.
Pretty Yoshi. Good. Yeah, it is very, very much like Yoshi. Very Yoshi inspired. But this came out. But before 92. We get any further, okay. You know, I'm going to play the of course, what we do in every single episode. Let's get ready to talk about it. So, of course, for the last time, that friggin' theme song. Now that theme song, Eric, when you heard it, when you watched it, and of course you just heard it just now.
Yes.
I hate the fact that it's not Huey Lewis, but I couldn't find anything about who it actually was. I think it's just the guy who writes the music for the show. So today we're talking about, as I said, the 13th episode of the second season, the 26th and final episode where all our questions are answered. Verne hatches an egg. It originally aired December 26th, 1992, the day after Christmas. Nothing about Christmas at all in this episode, in this whole season. It was written, four people are credited with writing this. Two people on the story, two people writing the screenplay. It was written by, or the story by the Clastorin brothers. I've talked about them in the past. One of them is a publicist. The other one is no longer with us. And then John Loy and John Luden. I've mentioned those names many times. Eric, you know, because you've listened to every episode, and directed by John Hayes, as all of these episodes this season were directed by Mr. John Hayes. Eric, we were in high school when this came out.
That's correct, yes.
So I feel like I probably thought I'm way too mature to watch this show. But
I was not.
I was going to say that. So you just, was this a Saturday? Were you still doing Saturday morning cartoons? I feel like I should have been. I missed them.
I remember watching even like Saved by the Bell in high school.
Oh, yes. That I remember watching.
Yes.
And Malibu Dreams. Maybe. I don't remember that. Malibu Dreams. Wasn't that a show?
That was also a show. But I think that was on maybe after Saved by the Bell. But I don't really remember watching that until it was in syndication. So
what bothers me is like already at this time, 92 is like the peak of my Back to the Future fandom. You know, I have all the movies on DVD now, and I'm now on VHS, and the four VHS box set. You know, the three movies and the secrets behind the Back to the Future secrets, whatever the hell it was called, with Kirk Cameron. And yet, I have very little memory of this cartoon, and maybe I'm wondering if I tried watching it and it was so bad I didn't. I don't know why. It never hit my radar.
I kind of remember watching that episode and thinking, oh, I'll watch this again. I remember, and it was never on again. So it wasn't like, oh, this is the last season. This is the last episode. Yep. It was just, hey, this is it. And then I don't really recall watching it after that.
So I watched,
obviously, yeah, it wasn't because I wasn't around.
No, I watched a video called The Chaotic Past. The Chaotic Past of Back to the Future, the animated series. I'm going to put a link to it in the show notes, where this guy talks about the animated series and says it was contracted for 2 seasons. Once those 2 seasons were up, it just, they never contracted it again. You know, they just kind of let it die. And I guess it was because it didn't really have good ratings, which isn't surprising because it's a good idea. Time travel adventures, you know, make the kids get in lots of trouble. And then Doc and Marty have to go help fix it and clean things up. But it's so
bad.
It's just so poorly done.
Do you think because of the kids? I didn't watch the rest of the episodes. Are the kids the main focus?
I think the writing. Yeah, the kids are pretty much the main focus. Mostly the younger kid, Verne. The older kid's very snooty and barely has many episodes. But it's just written because there's kids shows and kids cartoons that are written in a way that kids will enjoy it, but they're still kind of clever, you know. And parents are like, oh, they'll get jokes, and nothing like that with this, to me at least. But of course, I watched 26 episodes, and they've kind of melted my brain. I'm going to be talking about, even though this is the last episode to discuss in great detail, we're going to spend the next 4 hours talking about this 23-minute episode. I'm not completely finished with the animated series. There's more about that tomorrow. But do you want to jump right in? I have the episode in front of me. That's how I do it. I just kind of scrub through it to remind myself
Where does this episode rank on all the other ones you've watched? So finished them all.
And I fear that to answer that question, I give away too much of what's going to be happening tomorrow. So that's pretty much what tomorrow is. So how would you rate that compared to this one and that one in both seasons? And give me a step-by-step rating, rank them, bracket them. And so I'm not going to say any more than that, but you could tune in tomorrow. No, that's okay. That's perfectly fine. And if you want to come back tomorrow, you're more than welcome to, but yes, tomorrow, that's where the true madness of my rankings will be discussed or disgusted.
Could you post somewhere what their episode would be, the bracket? Or
oh yes, there is.
And maybe I could guess where they are.
I will give you what I have so far.
Yeah. Okay. Later on, send me a picture, and I'll show you. And I'll just guess to see where they are based on together. Title only. All right.
That's actually, I like that. Then I'll compare to where I don't want to see it. I won't even look at it until I finish the actual.
Right.
Because all I have is the seeding. I'll just say that. I don't have anything ranked yet. But
yeah. All right.
So this episode opens up just like every other one with Christopher Lloyd, live action Christopher Lloyd. And again, in that video I watched, they said, I didn't know this. I waited till I watched all the cartoons before I went to the YouTube video. He said that, you know, Bob Gale agreed to do it, but he wanted Christopher Lloyd involved. Christopher Lloyd was too busy to be able to do the voice, which is why he didn't. He only did the live action stuff, and they would film that pretty quickly. Like, it was very off the cuff. Like, if he messed up, they just keep going and edit around it. And it shows because it's kind of, you know, sloppily done. Like, this is the one you watch, but they're all like, he's either in front of a green screen doing something or he's in his lab. It's good stuff.
And how about Bill Nye?
Oh, Bill Nye. He said one thing in 26 episodes. He said, and it was like when he did an experiment for communication using a cup and two strings. And I don't even know if it was really him. It might've been, you know, someone else doing a voice later, ADRing his voice in. But other than that, he's like a mime. He's the science mime.
I learned about inertia this episode.
Is that what this one is? Yes.
Jesus
Christ. It's like the way they go, they take the episode and then they try to figure out, And I guess that was a Bob Gale thing too, trying to, I learned a lot from that video, trying to, like, you know, make it educational as well. And I mean, they are really stretching it with some of these things. Like last episode was a baseball episode. And was it a baseball episode? No, it wasn't. It was, who the hell can remember? But baseball was what Doc was doing. And then they're like, you can make your own cone. And then Bill Nye made a friggin' ice cream cone. I was like, what? What's the science going on here? But in this opening, it Doc is wearing a helmet that can tell if you are lying or telling the truth. And he's like, goes into a cookie jar. The alarm goes off. And he
didn't they have that in Back to the Future 1?
Well, no, he had that thing that he wore, and he put the suction cup on Marty, but it didn't work. Remember, he goes, do you know what this means? It means that this thing doesn't work.
Was it the same setup?
No, this was like,
oh, okay.
This was, you watched it, right?
Was it this episode?
Yes.
Oh, I don't remember this.
This is in the episode you're watching with the helmet at the beginning. He's in his lab. He's wearing a helmet that has a light on it and a megaphone attached to the helmet. This is the one with the dinosaur, right? You did watch this one.
Yes, the dinosaor, which I saw when I first did too.
See, and you've seen, right? You've watched this more than I have.
To the future. Back to the future.
That's what this cartoon does, dude. It makes you, like,
forget
everything and question what you're like. This whole thing was actually a CIA experiment to melt my brain. And it's some sort of like, he goes, I don't even remember what he said. I did. Usually I watch them and talk about them fairly shortly after this. I watched this one. Yeah, I definitely have to. And even then I still scrub through it, but I watched this one this morning and I'm like, okay, I'll remember as I go. So the episode opens up with Verne trying to steal a time machine.
Yes.
Now, what you don't understand is Doc's like, Verne, you know, you can't steal the time. You can't take the time machine out without permission. Doc, this whole series has been Verne just taking the time machine out willy-nilly whenever he wants. How many times he's done it? And then all of a sudden now he's going to create this rule that never existed before in the Brown family house. You also have to understand, this show doesn't deserve the amount of criticism I'm giving it. In other words, I'm putting way too much thought into it. Like the fact that these rules haven't existed before. And that's my fault because I can't help myself.
It's okay. I forgive you.
So he's all pissed at Verne. But Verne wants to get something good for his show and tell. We see Biff Jr. at school beating the shit out of some kid. And then he goes to tell Verne something. And that's when we discover Verne has these pills that turn things into food. Never seen before, but this, all of a sudden, that's how he eats all his food. Meatloaf, corn on the cob. And he takes the one thing that Verne had for show and tell, which was an arrowhead. I forgot, Doc gave him an arrowhead. And for some reason, Doc had it in his pocket. He goes, here, take this arrowhead. It's been in my pocket all day. And Biff Jr. gets high marks on his show and tell. And Verne has to have something to show the next day. Otherwise, he's going to have to be in the play with this girl. And he's going to have to kiss this girl, which he does not want to do.
I remember that.
You remember that? Oh, good, good, good. good. It would have been way better if I made you not watch it. And you're just telling me. And then I would say, and what do you think happens now with Verne?
So, the same results.
Very quickly, Verne is told he can't go back in time. So he tells Marty to take the DeLorean. Marty can go back in time whenever he wants. Marty drives the DeLorean around town like it's just, you know, you're like a sedan. He flies around on his hoverboard like it's normal. It's like they do all this crazy stuff that you'd think they were hiding. And they
pretty well out in the open. I agree.
It's just open. It's ridiculous. And the whole town seems to not know about time travel, but they know all about this. They know all about the DeLorean with all these weird things on it. And it looks like Verne wants to go back to 1 zillion BC. We don't get an exact date, but I'll say 1 zillion BC is where they go back to get something cool from the dinosaurs. Now, there is a previous episode, Eric, where they go back in time and they, now this is one of, this might be one of my favorites because of how bonkers it is. They go back in time and they accidentally stop the meteor that comes down and kills all the dinosaurs. So they, and they make friends with the dinosaur while they're there. Then they come back to our modern time and dinosaurs rule the world. They've evolved into giant dinosaurs that wear suits and walk around. And the DeLorean's like this tiny little thing. And they realize, oh my God, we erased all of humankind. So we have to go back and make sure the dinosaurs all die. So they go back in time again, stop themselves from stopping the meteor, and their dinosaur friend helps them get away and then looks at them. And I think he has a little tear in his eye as the meteor comes down to kill him and all the other dinosaurs in the world. it is the craziest thing I've ever seen. I was like, this is a children's, like they just made friends with the dinosaur and then killed it. The first few episodes have so much death. The Civil War, Verne was killed in the Civil War. Like his battalion, he accidentally went back in time and his battalion, I think, didn't survive. Marty is thrown in a lake because they think he's a witch, left to die, left to drown. In the third episode, they almost get, they're decapitated. They're ready. They have the chopping block. They have the executioner with the hood and the axe ready to lop off their heads. And I thought the death kind of died down a little bit, which was unfortunate. I thought at least it gave the show some edge. I don't think it realized it at the time how weird it seemed for a kid's cartoon. But you need to go back and now watch every episode. I feel like you have to. I'm going to make you somehow.
Want to hear a joke?
Yeah. You know what? Yes.
God said to the angels, hey, make the dinosaurs meteor. And the angels said, I will. And then the angel said to God, I gave the dinosaurs a meteor. And then God says, no, meteor.
Now, I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to ask you a real quick question. That joke.
Yeah.
Is the first time you heard it when you just said it just now?
Well, yeah. No. I didn't write it.
Okay. I thought maybe you just made it up just
no,
now.
No, I'm not that good.
Meteor. Okay. I thought maybe you just came up with it. Because that's the first time I heard it.
From TikTok.
Oh, I see. I don't mind. That's Tammy has TikTok.
I'm not allowed to go on TikTok anymore.
Now see, I want to take a segue and just talk about that. And why that is?
There's no real reason now.
I would love to know though. But we go back and we see all kinds of dinosaurs, all different colors, very much not quite Flintstone-y dinosaurs, but they're nice cartoony dinosaurs. Verne goes to steal an egg because what do? You do something completely unethical, steal a dinosaur's egg. They chase him back to the car. Luckily, they get back. And they're like, don't worry, I'm just going to use it for show and tell. I'll bring it back in no time. They fly away. It's like all of a sudden he's back. He's got the dinosaur, brings it into his house. I would say within 5 seconds, the friggin' thing hatches. And now we've got a friggin' dinosaur in Hill Valley. And then we cut to commercial. When that happened, were you on the edge of your seat?
No. Okay, I already saw it, remember?
That's right. You're like, oh, this again. This old exactly. thing. This is my favorite cat. Part. You were wild. I was like, yes, it's just like I remembered. We cut back to it. We get the back to the facts. And we have Doc saying, it is virtually impossible to break a raw egg by squeezing it lengthwise in the palm of your hand. Have you ever tried to do that?
Recently, yes.
Recently?
Yes.
It's been a long time since I tried. I think I learned that from Mr. Wizard on Nickelodeon.
Mr. Wizard was great. No, I was watching a Discovery Channel and I saw that. That's how the Romans built the arches by the shape of the egg.
Oh, I thought you meant by squeezing eggs. I was like,
No. So that's it for pressure. Yeah.
You know, Doc and Marty went back to Roman times. That was an okay episode. Maybe I love this show. Oh God, what is happening to me? I've done it years ago. And did the egg break or did it survive?
No, egg survived.
I think I did it right, but then I might have squeezed in the wrong spot, and then boom, egg all over the place. And there's some real the egg. Oh, that's right. Wait a minute. Where? Oh, the egg. Okay, so this one actually does play into it. The egg and the dinosaur egg and the end with Doc and the egg. It doesn't make any sense what actually Doc does, but I'll get there. We will tear it apart because that's what we do here. So we come back, and now he's got this cute little dinosaur that reminded you of, what did you say it was?
Yoshi.
It is very much like Yoshi from Mario Brothers. Super Mario Brothers. Not those normal Mario Brothers, the super ones.
Yes.
So the dinosaur is in the house. Clara comes in. Clara, voiced by Mary Steenburgen, one of the two original cast, well, original from the movies, cast members to reprise their voice. Do you know the other one?
Biff.
Biff, yes. Tom Boom. Wilson. He's not only Biff, he's every Tannen in every place. Every episode, there's a Tannen. There's Tannen in the Old West. There's Tannen in ancient Rome. There's Tannens in the 40s, the 50s. I mean, the 60s. Where even in the future, there's Tannens. They're inbreds. They have to be because there's so many of them. So she brings in a sundae, and this is, you know, now the dinosaur is hiding as a lamp, and Clara doesn't notice a thing. The dinosaur sticks his tongue out, and Clara pulls it like it's the chain of a lamp. Doesn't notice a thing. I mean, this is where I'm thinking, Clara, maybe back when she was tousled by the horse, she suffered some brain damage back in Back to the Future 3. We're just finding out about it now. It's slowly, you know, incapacitating her. So the dinosaur, I feel like
I really didn't like that part.
Yeah, I don't like most. That's get used
and then,
to
and
it.
And then the food too. And he's like, yeah, and I really like yes. You haven't enjoyed the last 26 days.
Sure. I enjoy the idea of watching it more than watching it. That's really what it is. The dinosaur sees Jules outside playing with Einstein, and he wants to go play, so he jumps out the window. And the dinosaur changes color a couple times. Like, he's light green, then he's dark green. Verne chases him. Einstein freaks out, and they're like, oh my God, there's a dinosaur. It starts licking Verne, and then it grows. Oh, no, not right away.
No, it started growing right away, you know, like the next day.
Yeah, it's not. It's like in the next scene. Because the dinosaurs, you know, they're arguing. He's like, you got to help me get the dinosaur back, you know, back home. And Einstein's freaking out. So Doc's like, I'm going to take him to the vet. Doesn't notice the friggin' dinosaur dressed up, like very much reminded me of like E.T., even though the idea of dressing him up reminded me of E.T., not the look or anything. But this dinosaur, I thought maybe the dinosaur would get a little bigger and, you know, attack the kids, but he's very playful. He's a very
that's
he's
how
a
it should have ended.
That's how the series should have ended, like a real downer. Do you remember that?
Yes, I was going to mention it, but go on. Yes.
I was going to talk about the
dinosaur TV show.
Yes. The live action dinosaur TV show, Back to the Meteor. The meteor, they all just kind of watched out the window as the meteor came to kill them.
Yeah, that was a great episode.
And I saw that like on YouTube decades later. I said, oh my God, do I have to watch this show? That is incredible that they actually went there. So this dinosaur, did you watch it?
I used to watch that before I started school, college. I used to wake up, it seemed to go on at 7 a.m. I used to watch it from 7. My parents were just like, what are you, an idiot?
You love that baby.
Yeah, that in the father, every room, right? So I remember that last episode was just scary and sad, and I was depressed. It's like, oh my God, they killed the dinosaurs.
I mean, you knew it was going to happen, but you didn't think it was going to happen to the domesticated family of dinosaurs. Incredible.
That's how this cartoon should have ended. They should have just died.
That would have been incredible. The dinosaurs took over Hill Valley. Everyone's dead.
And they just drive the DeLorean all the time.
The dinosaurs now they go back in time over and over to kill them again and again and again.
Yes.
So the dinosaur out of nowhere just grows, like literally blinks, and now he's three times the size, he's a different color, and he's still playful, he's still fun, and they're like, we got to figure out, you know, how to get him home or some shit like that. he starts ripping up the garden. Clara's like, oh my God, we must have big gophers, because Clara and Doc are, they're buffoons in these, I guess the kids are supposed to be the smart one, and kids show you want the parents to be kind of dopey, but they are really dopey. Doc is at the vet and Einstein's completely fine, but then the dinosaur just happens to walk right by and now he's freaking out again. No one notices. They don't notice flying hoverboards, flying cars, or dinosaurs. Okay.
I don't remember that.
I feel like I'm going to stop every few seconds just to see if you want to interject, because otherwise I'll keep yapping. And I love it. I love the silence. I was, I love it. I'm having so much fun right now.
I can't watch you. I know you're ready for me to say something. I have nothing to add.
Oh, you know what? You know what I can do?
I was, yes.
Okay. You can see it now, right?
I can watch it now. Yes.
No,
I'm still not
going to
watch it. I'm still not going to
look at it go. Now we can watch Jackie Gleason while we eat. All right. So I'm just going to.
What's her rerun?
You'll find out. Oh, that's right. Why did I watch this goddamn cartoon? So the dinosaur's now at his, at like, I don't know, a store.
Oh, that's right. Each quarters.
And yeah, like this kid jumps on it. You should have ravaged the kid, ravaged the mother. Yeah. No, everyone, he's just like, oh, he doesn't know what's going on. I think they put a sign up like a lost dinosaur. But of course, this is where the Tannins get involved. Now, you don't know this, but the character we're about to meet, this isn't the first time we've seen him. So this is a recurring character, Mr. Wisdom, I believe his name is. And so now the Tannins are at their house. There's Biff Jr. And you know, if that's Biff Jr., you know who his son is, right?
No.
It has to be Griff. If that's Biff and that's Biff Jr., Griff has to be that kid's son. From Back to the Future 2. Because his grandfather was Biff.
Oh, okay. Yes. Yeah. All right. I thought Griff was from Wild West 1, number 3.
No, that's Buford.
Oh, sorry.
I get all pissy. So
just connect me.
Biff, thanks. It's gone. And then I erase all the Eric episodes.
That's right. This guy was all weird too. What was this about too?
So this guy is Mr. Wisdom. Now, was in a previous episode. He is this Mr. Wizard type guy that just wants you to buy all his shit. Verne loves him, and Verne wanted to go see him in person at the mall. Turns out that he's a fake. Like, he takes the glasses off and he's just like this guy who talks. And I think it's also Biff, Tom Wilson doing that voice too. He's just this real crotchety, like, evil guy. And it turns out that he knew Verne. Well, when Verne said, my dad, Dr. Brown, he's like, Doc Brown? He was a college roommate of Doc Brown and stole Doc's invention for the self-spinning hula hoop. This is the stuff that I get to watch. And then Doc blamed him for stealing his idea. He got rich and became Mr. Wisdom, this TV show host. So then Doc goes and challenges him to inventions live on TV. Now, Mr. Wisdom stole all his inventions from Doc. So every single invention that he tries to say is his, Doc knows how to like change up and fix. And he puts on this memory thing that doesn't quite work, this memory hat, and it scrambles his brains and gives him what I thought was permanent brain damage. He literally grabbed his lip and went, blah, 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 and he was just completely out of it. Now he's back and he's fine. And there's nothing like, okay. There was just no, he's still evil. He still has a TV show. Apparently the brain damage was only temporary. Now I've filled you in. You know everything you need to know about Mr. Wisdom. So
that's the best type of brain damage to have.
Right.
Temporary one.
That's true. You want him to come back. So Biff himself is, you know, I seems to be bored, but very randomly, while Biff Jr. is watching Mr. Wisdom said, remember, folks, I'll give you $50,000 if you can bring me an alien, maybe a Bigfoot or something, or a dinosaur. I'm like, what? Like, what is, like, what? Who would have any of these things? Never mind a dinosaur. But I guess,
I mean, imagine just giving someone like $10,000.
Right. He's no got $50,000. Jesus Christ. Who would give, never mind giving, you know, $50,000 for a dinosaur, but imagine like a fifth of that, like $10,000 to someone for no reason.
No reason at all. It's because they have nice eyes.
Jesus. That's $5,000 an eye. Oh, if I could only.
She only had one.
Oh, no. Then it's a one expensive eye. It's one good eye. She needed it for the second eye. She needed it for the second eye.
She was a pirate.
Oh. There was an episode of Back. Everything goes back to this cartoon. Mac the Black. Marty's a pirate. My. So, Biff's like, oh, $50,000. I wish I could see a dinosaur or whatever. And this is how I talk to him. I'm like, I can only care so much. He looks outside. There's a dinosaur right there. He's like, oh, great. I'm going to take you and make money off you. I don't know how he got the dinosaur in the house. None of it seems to matter. So Verne finally tells Doc the truth of what's going on. They're like, we need to find the dinosaur. Einstein seems to be, he's resting like in a hospital bed. I didn't even get that. Watching TV. There's the dinosaur with Mr. Wisdom. He's going to show off the dinosaur live on TV with Biff Tannen. But then he takes his hat up and you see he's really like a curmudgeon-y guy. And he has these lab rats that he wants to sick on kids. Even the kids, if they don't cheer enough, he's going to sick the rats on them. We see the dinosaur in the back and he's sad and he's crying. Well, he's very sad and he's in this cage. And it reminded me of something. And I'm going to talk about something that I probably was too old to watch. But Eric, have you ever seen the amazing film Follow That Bird? So anyway, there he's in the cage. So Follow That Bird is the story of not just any bird, but Big Bird. And Big Bird goes on an adventure. And at one point he gets caught in this like sideshow and he's sad sitting in a cage and he's just, and he's really depressed and sad. Anytime I see an animal in a cage or a cartoon animal, it just makes me think of Big Bird and
He's always sad, Big Bird, though, for the most part.
He kind of, yeah. But he just, like, it just was, like, really depressing behind that cage. Wow. And there were other birds, too. And it was just like, oh, he was trying to go find his family. And instead, he found the inside of a prison cell. He got away, though. I think Elmo and Oscar and some of those other mofos left the street and came to save him. So Mr. Wisdom is like, how you doing there, dinosaur? He goes, all you have to do is last one day because then I'm going to take you and I'm going to sell your parts for millions of dollars. This would be the biggest story in the world, by the way, if there was a dinosaur just on live TV. So he sneaks away all excited. The Browns show up. Somehow they have a giant Brinks armored car. Don't know where it came from. Don't know where the uniforms came from. None of that matters because this is the kind of stuff, Eric, where it's stupidly done. You know what I mean? Like it's, and I know it's made for kids, but I'm not a kid. I can't help but look at it through my very mature eyes.
I get you.
Did you love this part? You did watch this episode, right?
I don't remember this part either. I know I watched it.
When you watched it, when did you
watch it? I was working, but.
Was it today?
Yeah.
And well, I, you know
like,
what?
Like 3 hours ago.
Jesus. So you've watched it closely. You've watched it more than me and sooner
right,
than me.
Yeah, like, yeah.
But, you know, for the work you're doing, at least that shows that you're focused on your work. So there's that. Anyone listening who works with you, they'll be like, oh, that's good that he's not solely focused on the series finale of Back to the Future, the animated series. So Doc and Clara, I have to say, Clara looks pretty cute here dressed up as in her uniform.
Yeah, Ken G's baby.
She's got two eyes. So yeah, she's like, we have the money in here. And the guy's like, oh, okay, lets him in. They sneak out. Marty and the kids are there. They see the Tiny, the dinosaur. He's really sad looking here. There. Oh, see that look on his face? I can't take it. Anything in a cartoon, anything you cry? Oh, it makes me sad. Mostly in cartoons. Real life,
now,
you can cry all you
want. Now, if it was a person, would you feel sad?
It's probably not. I funny, I watch
POW camps, you know, like something like
Jesus
that.
Christ. No, that would make me sad. I watch MasterChef Junior. I don't know if you're familiar with that show. And I watch MasterChef. And when adults cry on reality shows, I kind of giggle. But when kids cry on reality shows, I'm like, oh, no, they don't understand. Oh, these kids. So, you know, and then these kids cry very frequently when they get when Gordon Ramsay calls them shitheads and kicks them out. He doesn't do that. So Mr. Wisdom's ready to go on the air. Now, they're saying, you know, Tiny, we're going to get you out of here. We're going to save you. So while Mr. Wisdom is getting ready, why don't they just leave? They could have just left. The kids are all excited. He's ready to show off the great dinosaur. He opens up the curtain. Oh, first he gives Biff and Biff Jr. come out. He gives them a big check for 50,000 smackaroos. Then he goes, let's see our dinosaur. Opens it up, and there's a dinosaur costume. Again, I have to ask, when was this created? How quickly was this knitted? Did they bring this in? This must have been part of the plan. So hours ago, they're feverishly knitting together this thing so that when they open the curtain, they see a fake dinosaur. It falls apart really quick, and we see that it's actually Marty and Jules on stilts. And Mr. Wisdom's like, hey, what the hell? Why didn't they just leave? If they just left, they'd already be gone. It was a smooth getaway, but they had to stay behind to throw it in Mr. Wisdom's face, to just laugh at him. He's just trying to make an honest buck by killing a dinosaur that shouldn't even be in this time. Biff's money gets ripped up. They get taken away. They just jump in the car and they drive off. Nothing. We don't see. They drive away. We don't see the guy chasing them. There's no, they don't run into any issues, no problems. And now the dinosaur, he's even bigger. They set up a cart on the back of the train so that he could fit in it. And he's like, great, okay, now you can. He gives a little lick to Verne. They get on the train. Oh, and he's like, Verne's still pissed that he's not going to have something for his show and tell. And luckily, this dinosaur's tooth fell out. Now, who knows? Maybe he won't be able to survive now. But his tooth falls out, and Jules is like, awesome, I have a dinosaur tooth. I mean, Verne, I'm sorry, has a dinosaur tooth. Very excited. He, the plane flies away, and that's it. That's the end of the cartoon. That's the end of the story. That's it. It just ends. Eric, are you as pissed off as I am?
I'm worried about the baby dinosaur getting rejected from his mom. And
right?
Dies.
He goes back, and the mother's like, who is this?
Who
and
is
they
this?
Just... They grabs him in her maw and rips him around, and then boom, dead. What if they ran into the other dinosaur that they left behind the first time?
The mother, yeah.
I mean, it is. There's not a lot of consequence. There's not very often do they have an episode where the time travel, they come back and something changes, and I'm like, oh, that was clever. So there was one episode where they went back in time. It was a stupid reason to go back in time to get the blueprints for these shoes that help you dance so that Verne could learn to dance. Marty ends up accidentally joining the army, and Verne, without the shoes, has to show up at a dance contest and he takes dance lessons from this old woman. He takes the dance contest with this girl and to help while he's helping Marty get out and come back to the future. When he gets back to he wins the contest. When he gets back to the future, he goes back to the dance class, and the woman says, you know, I once won this contest back in 1944. And you realize that dance teacher the whole time was the little girl in the past. Said, oh, wow, they actually did something somewhat clever. Not a lot, doesn't happen a lot in the show, but it did happen momentarily there. I got really nervous that I wasn't recording, but I think I still am recording.
Am I still here? Hello?
I hope so. Am I?
Okay, yeah.
Wait a minute. Stop recording. Oh, my God. I didn't see recording in the corner because I'm sharing my screen, and I thought, oh, my God. So we're good. We're good. We're good. So now we get to the live portion part, and this is where Doc, the genius who invented the flux capacitor, who invented time travel, the man who could see the world at any time, they make him a little stupid here because he talks about how eggs are, you know, you, if you have an unfertilized egg, you can eat them. The fertilized eggs are the ones that, you know, chickens come from. And then he's like showing off all this friggin', I forget what the hell he's showing. Oh, how to tell between a hard-boiled egg and a regular egg. And then we get Bill Nye, the quiet guy, who shows up with two eggs. One's hard-boiled, one's not. And all he does is spin them. Oh, yes.
Which one do you think was hard-boiled, the left hand or right hand? But I think it's too late now.
I think it's too late because I couldn't tell by looking.
Right. I know.
But once he spun them, I said, oh, I figured the hard-boiled one must be the one that spins faster. Oh, look at that microwave in the background. It's so tiny. Such an 80s-looking microwave. Yeah, it doesn't matter. It just talks about inertia. And you said you learned about inertia today for the first time?
Well, that in 1992 when I first watched the episode.
So why don't you tell the audience what your thoughts on inertia and what you learned from it.
The egg inside has a liquid.
Yes.
And the liquid wants to move around, so that's why it's tough for the egg to gain speed. But when it's a solid egg...
That's right.
Yeah.
And this is where it loses me. This is where Doc loses me. This is the last time... No, this isn't the last time he plays Doc, because he's in the ride, too. And this is way before the ride. This is only 2 years after Back to the Future 3.
Wait a minute. The ride, 1991.
Oh, my God. Really?
I was on that ride in 1991.
Well, I didn't go on it till 2000. Maybe that's why I'm just way behind.
Yeah.
Wow. So I wonder if this is the last, because he's done skits, he's done commercials, but is this the last officially like scripted Back to the Future Doc Brown thing? And this is what we see. Him with two eggs, and he forgets which one is the hard-boiled one and which one is not. Now, Doc, Bill Nye just showed you how to tell the difference. Right. He didn't want to spin them. Okay? But here's what bothers me. He goes, this one's the hard-boiled egg. It has to be. So then he goes to bite into it. Why would you? I've only been into hard-boiled eggs the last few years. Growing up, I never ate them. But it was my understanding that once you hard-boiled them, you still took the shell off before you ate them. Am I right?
Correct. Yes. Yeah, that's correct. Yes. I've never had a hard-boiled egg, though.
I just had some in a salad like half an hour ago.
Nope.
Okay. So, but you've painted them as kids, right?
Not really.
For Easter? No.
No. At a sad childhood.
This is going. So, okay. If you had $10,000 worth of eggs and 5,000 were hard-boiled. So, okay.
I'd give them to a girl. So...
My point is you take the shell off. You've seen a goddamn hard-boiled egg, right?
Yes.
The shell's off it, correct?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Good. Why wouldn't Doc know this? Why would he do this to... Why? That's the last thing we see is wearing the stupid hat, putting the wrong egg into his mouth, yolks everywhere.
Gross.
And then he gives this little thing like, oh, see you in the future. And I'm like, Doc, no, you won't.
There is no future.
There is no future, only Zool. And then the first season, the episodes all ended with little jokes with Biff at the very end. Not anymore. Copyright 1992 by Universal Cartoon Studios and Amblin Entertainment. There it is, folks. The final animated episode. I made Eric watch it.
What? Again?
Again. And he remembers less than I do. He watched it just a few hours ago, but thankfully he was focused on his work. I watched it before work. And that's why every time I turn the volume down. I just scrub my way through it to remember what the hell I just saw.
And you know, Christopher Lloyd in that last episode was probably 6 years older than us.
Okay. We're going to look it up right now to get depressed. Christopher Lloyd.
I have it right here.
Oh.
1938.
So 1938. All right. I'm going to do the math. 48, 58, 68, 78, 88. He's 50. And right. So he's 54.
That's right.
Yeah. What'd you say? 8 years?
I'm a little bit older than you. Yeah. So.
Holy geez. It's funny when like my brother turned 50 this year and like you look at 50-year-olds like was it Wilford Brimley or whatever, like when they turn 50, they look like old men. And
well, he's 85 now.
That's crazy.
So that means
I know.
By the time that I watched it, I'll be dead.
Oh, Jesus Christ. So have you seen the movie Nowhere or Nobody with Bob Odenkirk?
No.
He's in that. He plays his dad. And he's an old man. You know, he was in an episode of The Mandalorian this past year too. And it's like, oh, he's just an old fella, but he's still.
I heard you mention him talk about Jim from Taxi.
Yes.
And he mentioned that. I like that episode.
Reverend
yes.
Jim now.
Yes.
Yes. Eric, I've told you he was on Sitcom All Ye Faithful for three times. He was on for Tony Banta with Taxi with Reverend Jim, Christopher Lloyd, Tony Maselli with Who's the Boss? And then I made him watch Give Me a Break. And I bet you his thought after he watched it was, give me a break. Because we couldn't stay with another Tony Danza sitcom. Well, I guess we could have, but there was like, I don't think there were very good ones after that. We should have gone back and we will go back. Eric, I hope you will join me again for Sitcom All Ye Faithful later this year. And we'll return to watch. We'll actually do one of your choice, but if you want to go back to Taxi, we'll go back to the Sunshine Cab Company.
I'm looking forward to that. That's probably one of my favorite ones to watch is the Christmas time one. So thank you.
Excellent. Awesome. I'm looking forward to that too. Before we get out of here, I just want to do the usual housekeeping. You can find me on all the social medias at Geek Mentality. That's Twitter, Instagram, Threads, Mastodon.social, and Blue Sky. On Facebook, it's Fans Not Experts. On YouTube, it's Fans Not Experts. And the website is fansnotexperts.com. Eric, anything you want to say or plug or anything you want to...
Don't look for me, please.
Don't look for Eric anywhere. Now, the other day, you said you had a quiz for me. What happened?
Oh.
I
forgot about that.
So, well, another thing that's great is on the name, because on the Zoom, there's a name. And I was like, what the hell is this name? Eric's name didn't pop up on Zoom. It's Match O'Malley. And I was like, it took me a while to figure it out. But Eric, nice little Easter egg. That is Billy Zane's character in the original Back to the Future. Well, I guess in Back to the Future 2 as well. He was, because he did return in the... when they had the sports almanac in the 50s. But he will not be Match O'Malley when he returns this December. Any final thoughts or parting words before we get out of here?
None, but thank you once again for having me on.
Always
fun. So thank you.
I love it. Thank you. Thank you for joining me. This has been fun. It has been hilarious. And we're laughing for things that we didn't even discuss on the show, but there's still anytime we get together, we laugh a lot. So I love it. Thank you, Eric. Thank you, listener. I'll be back tomorrow to talk more animated series. Even though there's no more episodes to talk about, we're finally going to figure out what is the best animated episode, the best episode from this animated series. And then after that, there'll be one final Marchy McFly. But until then, thank you for listening. Thank you for subscribing. Thank you to Eric. And
this is my theme song.
Close enough.
Welcome to my theme song.
Here is I'm not even going to say it. This is my podcast. I made it. Geek Mentality is what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe. Cause I'm kinda funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time. And I'm kinda handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. At least listen to this episode. That was awesome. You do it every time too. But I love it that actually I was hoping you would do it again.
And I'm trying to do it. I'm so confident I did it right.
Fans Not Experts.